it's Fran. Some interesting space news. If you didn't see my live cast of the Starship Super Heavy launch, check it out. This was interesting in the paper. It's a New York Times Observatory. This image, the James Webb took this image last year, and it turns out right here in this image, these three little blobs, it's three images of the same galaxy at three different times taken in one image. And one of them contains a Class A supernova, and that's really what got the attention. You can see right there a supernova happening in the outer spiral arm of this very, very distant galaxy. But these other two images are also the very same galaxy at two different times. There's one is 320 days after the supernova, and the other is about 1,000 days after the supernova. All three images of the same galaxy in the same image taken by the James Webb. A very curious Einsteinian reality of gravitational lensing. Those images are from photons that are traveling at the speed of light, but with gravitational lensing, in the case of this image, which was bent around a massive cluster of galaxies, we're talking about a very large gravitational influence that is not spherical because it is a cluster of galaxies, so it's sort of potato-shaped, this gravitational lens. And so there were at least three different paths through this gravitational lens that this image of this galaxy, which is actually behind the cluster. So we're actually looking at the galactic cluster, and then behind the cluster, which we can't see directly, is this galaxy. And its image is being gravitationally lensed around the obstruction, the galaxy cluster in front of it. But because that cluster is sort of oddly shaped, that there are three different paths of light, which are obviously 1,000 light days apart in distance. So some of those paths were quicker, and some were much more roundabout. And the result was having a single image, single telescopic image in the far infrared, mind you, of the same galaxy three times at three different times. It's very interesting that one of the things I've noticed in looking through the James Webb images, nearly every single image from the James Webb has gravitational lensing in it. You can see gravitational lensing everywhere. In Hubble, it was something that was seen often, but not like every single image. But a lot of it, I think, has to do with the fact that the James Webb is looking in the far infrared. So we're looking at the most stretched frequencies of light, and we're looking at the most distant galaxies. So with James Webb, just because of the change in redshift and such that it's able to detect, we're looking at galaxies that are much, much more distant than anything that Hubble could really image, given the frequencies that were limited to what Hubble could see. So the further the galaxies that we're seeing, like much, much further, well, many of them are getting gravitationally lensed because there's just so much stuff, so many galaxies, so many stars between here and these extremely distant galaxies. Yeah, fascinating stuff. I highly recommend that you keep up on the James Webb images that are up on the NASA site. Interesting side note was this article about ground-based observatories, particularly the ones that are being built right now that have massive arrays of mirrors. Problems I never really considered. as it says from the article, one of the astronomers, Mike Brotherton, says, "It's hard to keep a mirror pristine. It's a balance between opening the building to take data or protecting the mirror." And really, they're talking about birds, bird poo. It's just talking about 20-foot, optical telescopes, just trying to keep the birds off of them. So it's not only birds that can deface a mirror, says Mike Brotherton, current director of the Wyoming Observatory. posted a picture on Facebook of frost that had accumulated on the mirror while the dome was open for observation. Yeah, so you have accumulation of frost and dew and poo. So the author of this article, Dennis Overby, recent visits to La Campanas Observatory in Chile, says, as my host showed off one of their prized telescope mirrors, 20 feet of shiny, immaculately curved aluminum-coated glass, I couldn't help noticing a small, conspicuous smudge. It looked like the kind of smear you might find on your windshield in the morning, especially if you had parked under a tree. Birds, one astronomer grumbled when asked what it was. It happens all the time. We went up on several platforms and looked down, and there were bird droppings all over the mirror. It looked awful. They also talk about a very interesting incident that I had never heard of. It says, some things are less easy to fix. On February 5th, 1970, a new employee at the McDonald Observatory in West Texas took a gun to work and opened fire first at his boss and then several times point blank at the primary mirror of the observatory's new 2.7-meter reflecting telescope. And then he went at it with a hammer. I'd like to find out a little more about this, the new employee that shot their boss or shot at their boss and then tried to destroy the telescope. What gives? Strangely, they said no one was hurt during the assault, and aside from several small bullet holes, which affected only about 1% of the mirror's surface area, the telescope was virtually unscathed. The telescope resumed its observing program the following night. And they talk about Hubble, the Hubble issue with the mirror being, you know, misshaped on the ground. Because the company that made the mirror for the Hubble, they made mirrors for ground-based telescopes, and they did not take into consideration that when the telescope mirror was no longer under the force of gravity, that it would change shape. And it did. And of course, they talk about the James Webb getting pelted by a micrometeorite, but that hasn't really, you know, knocked that thing up. But yeah, the daily struggle with the telescopes between using the telescope and protecting the telescope. And you should know about the passing of Virginia Norwood, 96 years old, pretty much single-handedly made Landsat a success. The article goes on to talk about the fact that when Landsat 1 was being designed, that RCA had the contract to have the majority of the payload for Landsat because they had planned to make it an optical Earth-observing satellite with a set of RCA video cameras on it and all of the electronics and telemetry and everything to relay that data. And but Virginia Norwood's little device, which was going to be an image scanner to take a high resolution scans of the terrain using her custom radio system, it got a tiny little spot on the Landsat. It says, NASA and the Geological Survey planned to use a giant three-camera system designed by RCA based on television tube technology that had been used to map the moon. The bulk of the mission's 4,000-pound payload was reserved for the RCA equipment. Ms. Norwood and Hughes were told that their multispectral scanner system, or MSS, could be included in the launch if it weighed no more than 100 pounds. So they squeezed it in there. And 2 days after launch, they were getting images back from their scanning system. And, serendipitously, the RCA system was supposed to be the primary recording instrument aboard the satellite and the MSS a secondary experiment. But once we looked at the data, the roles were switched, they said. And, 2 weeks after liftoff, just 2 weeks into the life of the satellite, power surges in the RCA camera system endangered the satellite, and the cameras had to be shut down. So it just became their scanning image system after a couple weeks. And that's some examples here of the scanning Yosemite. So Virginia Norwood, a physicist, was the person primarily responsible for designing and championing the scanner that made the program possible, the Landsat program. NASA called her the mother of Landsat. Ms. Norwood, who is part of an advanced design group in the Space and Communication Division at Hughes, canvassed scientists who specialized in agriculture, meteorology, pollution, and geology. She concluded that a scanner that recorded multiple spectra of light and energy, like the one that had been used for local agricultural observations, could be modified for the planetary project that the Geological Survey and NASA had in mind. And they talk about the typical stuff of, you know, her being at the top of a very large engineering food chain. One man, faced with the prospect of having Ms. Norwood as his boss, quit, saying he did not want to work for a woman, the MIT Technology Review article said. He returned several years later asking for a job, but she refused him. Oh, payback. But yeah, Virginia Norwood, 96, nearly a century. A life well lived. Well, that's it for space news. There'll be more about the Starship Super Heavy launch. I spent most of the day going back and watching the footage. I watched the various channels, all their different angles and such. Interesting thing about the launch was, although I was live, commenting on the live stream, I didn't have a high definition picture while I was watching it live. I had to wait until after I was done my stream to actually go back and watch it in HD on the big monitor. It looked like, even before liftoff, several of the outer engines had blown up. There was big chunks of debris that were raining down in the launch area just at liftoff. And when the rocket finally started to ascend, it appeared like there were large, like SUV-sized pieces being flung up, almost as high as the rocket and then disappearing. And in flight, I did notice in the replay several times some of the outboard motors, it appeared like they had exploded in flight, blowing out not only pieces of shrapnel from the engines, but also the skirting that was around the bottom of the rocket was also blown away. Ultimately, I think as of a couple hours ago, that they said it was likely due to hydraulic failure, that the gimbaling engines got stuck and also wouldn't shut down. As the rocket began to tumble, I was actually watching the telemetry data, and the liquid oxygen meter was going down almost to zero. That it still had a lot of methane fuel, but the liquid oxygen, it was going down fast, like it was just running through the oxygen and wasn't running much fuel. There was a lot going on there in the telemetry. So when they actually showed the rocket from the ground, the telescopic cameras, when they zoomed in on the engines that were lit, when it was in the lower altitude, where before it got really obscured with just haze, it really did appear, at least in those high definition images, that the engines that were out in the perimeter weren't just out, they appeared to be gone. It was pretty well illuminated, but you couldn't see any engine bells or anything, and there was a lot of damage in the skirting. It looked like those engines were no more, which I don't know. It's a testament to the redundancy in the design that it could literally blow up six engines and keep flying. That was pretty remarkable. I am looking forward to launch number two. I'm sure everyone who's following this is equally enthused to see it fly again. They say they're going to get another one up pretty soon and try again. So when they do, we'll be here. We'll stream it. So, all right. Well, that's it. I'm Fran. Thanks to the patrons. Thank you. Everybody on Patreon for making all this weird stuff possible. I don't know. So thank you to the patrons. And I'll be back here at the bench real soon. My love.
that's what you're watching. Friend, that's what I'm doing. Working at the bench.